Are you aware of Rupert Sheldrake's work?
Yes, oh, indeed. I've interacted with Rupert Sheldrake in some of the debates in the Institute of Art and Ideas, which is the big cultural festival here in the United Kingdom. Yes, no, I do understand quite a bit where Rupert Sheldrake is coming from. He's another major critic, incidentally, of the neo-Darwinist view of evolution. Yes. But what in particular about Rupert Sheldrake are you interested in?
He has an idea called morphic resonance, and I want to know what you think of it.
Yes, that's right. Yes, yes. Well, look, it's not utterly crazy. I know what most people think about Rupert Sheldrake, which is he's all over the place, and I don't know whether anything he says has any significance. He's actually a very well-trained chemist and biochemist from Cambridge University. He's thought very deeply about these issues. And I think the idea of resonance shouldn't be dismissed.
Can you explain that idea?
Yes, right. Oh, yes, okay. Well, actually, it might be best for me to just explain the little book that I published nearly 20 years ago, The Music of Life.
Yes, sure.
I use the analogy of music for a very particular reason. It proved to be a useful metaphor for many life processes, like, for example, there happen to be almost as many genes underlying the making of proteins in our bodies as there are organ pipes in the biggest organ in the world, which is in the Wanamaker organ in Philadelphia, and not surprisingly in the United States. And I draw the analogy that, of course, it's not the organ itself that creates the music. It's Bach who wrote his fugues and the player who plays the notes, which would be the equivalent of the genes here. But I have thought further about this question of resonance. It seems to me that quite a number of oscillatory processes in the body, that's processes that go up and down like this in a
yes.
rhythm, the heart rhythm, the respiratory rhythm, the circadian rhythm, the monthly rhythms that humans show, and even rhythms over many years that certain species show, indicate that there are associations between one type and the other. Let me give one very good example. As I breathe in and out, if somebody was recording the frequency of my heartbeat, you'd find the variations in the frequency of the heartbeat in synchrony with my breathing in and out. This is incidentally how long-term meditators manage to bring their heart rates down, because when you breathe like this in a meditative way, in quickly, out very slowly, there are physiological processes, we don't need to go into the technical detail, which actually create that slowing down of the heart rate. Now, the point I'm making here is that we already know there are associations between some processes that occur very rapidly, like the heartbeat, and other processes occur more slowly, like the breathing, respiratory process, mm-hmm. and then others occur even more slowly, a daily rhythm or a monthly rhythm or whatever it might be. So the idea of morphic resonance, and morphic just means the shape of something, the what it manifests in what it shows, it is the shape. The idea of morphic resonance in Sheldrake's view is simply the idea that such entrainment, that's the word I think I'm after,
right,
of one rhythm mechanism by another, so that there are associations between the two, is proven. That's not in doubt. Now, how deep all of this goes and whether his idea that somehow most of the cells of our body have morphic resonance with the other cells, I don't know. I've not done the physiology to work that out. But it's not totally crazy. All cells pour out these vesicles we were discussing earlier that can pass to the germline. All cells communicate with other cells in the body through the extracellular vesicles. I'm pretty certain that that is one of the ways in which a multicellular organism like us can survive, because unless individual cells recognize that they are part of a tissue that cooperates, we get cancer. What is cancer? It is cells going off on their own and doing their own thing, and very much to the disadvantage of us as an organism. The point I'm making here is that I think the idea that cells talk to each other in this kind of way certainly would be a medium through which certain kinds of resonance could be created. But I'm not proving anything at the moment on that. I'm just simply saying the ideas of morphic resonance shouldn't be dismissed out of hand. They just need good further experimentation to work out what are the ways in which the different cyclic processes in the body entrain each other and influence each other. That they do, we already know. The extent to which they do it, I think, remains open for further thought and investigation.
This is interesting because in Chinese medicine, there's also an emphasis on holism. Even though we didn't use that word recently, holistic has its threads throughout this conversation.
Indeed it is. And I agree with the word holism. It is. But let me also say something about holism. I know the neo-Darwinists particularly will dismiss me as completely off my head when I talk about holism. They will think it's all terribly vague.
All right.
Actually, it's a mathematical necessity. And this may surprise people. It's 2016, so it's now about 8 years ago, I published a book called Dance to the Tune of Life. I'll send the details of that to you. But I published a book.
Sure.
Which had as its subtitle Biological Relativity.
Biological Relativity.
Biological relativity is the idea that there is no privileged level of causation within a biological system. Now, that is a mathematical necessity for the following reasons, and I can illustrate it best with how I modeled the heartbeat, over 60 years ago now, when I was a research student. I was looking at ion channels in the heart cells, characterizing those so that we could fit equations to characterize their physical properties. And then you can work out how that influences the overall electrical potential in the heart cell, because the heart rhythm is an electrical process. The voltage on the cell literally goes up and down like that. Now, what I showed there was that you could not explain the rhythm from the molecular elements alone. If you take those proteins and you put them in a solution with no membrane around them, in other words, not in a cell, they will not oscillate. There's no rhythm. If, therefore, you remove the cell membrane and its electrical potential, it doesn't work. Incidentally, that's also true of mitochondria, our energy factories in our bodies. If you remove the electrical potential across the membranes, the system no longer works. So that's not itself a new discovery. Now, what I then came up with is a very simple point. You can fit differential equations. Sorry to be technical for a moment.
Sorry to interrupt. Just so you know, Denis, my background's in mathematical physics.
Yes.
And this podcast, the audience members are researchers in physics, math, right, philosophy, biology, and so on. So you, yes, can be technical. Don't worry.
Okay. So they won't mind differential equations being referred to.
Yes.
That's very good to know. I'm delighted. Anyway, the point is very simple. however many details you put into the equations for the differential equations and the functions used in those equations, you need the boundary conditions. Otherwise, there's no solution to those equations. Every mathematician knows that. Where do those boundary conditions come from? Well, in a sense, the word gives it away, doesn't it? In the case of a cell, it's what the membranes constrain the molecules to do. Those are the boundary conditions. So, holistic view is simply the enumeration of the boundary conditions in a differential equation model. So, that's why I call it a mathematical necessity. And I think that your listeners who would understand the mathematics here will readily understand when I say that there's no solution to a set of differential equations without the boundary conditions being put in. Those are the influence from the higher levels of organization, because it's those higher levels of organization that constrain what the molecules themselves are doing. Think of how life must have emerged long ago in, we don't know exactly where, perhaps in the minute fissures and cracks in thermal vents, who knows. But until the living system, the networks of interactions that were forming autocatalytic sets, meaning chemical reactions that could continue indefinitely, until they were enclosed within membranes, they would have just dispersed. So somehow or another, that constraint, the forming of a membrane around a catalytic set, would have been a key element in any form of evolution of what we call life. So right from the very beginning, the boundary conditions by the structure in which the molecules are to be found are a critical element in determining how they behave. And so there's nothing terribly surprising in that. The principle of biological relativity is simply that you will always need the boundary conditions as well as the differential equations.
So that's extremely interesting. Are you making an analogy between the evolution laws and reductionism and the boundary conditions and holism?
I am saying that the boundary conditions are what give the system its whole. Yes, that's right. If what you're referring to as the whole is the structure of the system, then it is that structure that creates the boundary conditions. Cells are packed with structures that do that. The molecules are not free to move easily from one compartment to another. They're restricted to various compartments. That is itself a structural imposition of constraint on the molecules involved. All I'm saying is that all molecules in living systems are constrained in the same kind of way. So, yes, if you want to say that holism is the existence of boundary conditions from structure, then I think that's absolutely right. But then you've got to look at the whole to see the structure. If you look at just the individual pixels in a message, you won't understand the message. It's the same point, isn't it?
Yes.
You can't understand the movements of individual molecules in a system without understanding the constraints produced by the whole system, which means the structure of the system.
If you enjoyed this Toe clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toe Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toe community. You'll also receive my top 10 toes. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's obsession.